So our first keynote speaker is Dr. Jean-Claude Burgelman from the European Commission. He is head of unit science policy and foresights, research and innovation. He's currently the head of the unit, and he has started his career at the EC already in 1999, and he has had several posts in the Commission during these years. Before his career at the Commission, he was the professor of communication technology policy at the University of Brussels. Jean-Claude has been the key person behind the open science consultation and the stakeholder discussions, and we are very eager now to hear what was the results of the consultation and the discussions, and especially what will follow now. So please, Jean-Claude, the floor is yours.
Thank you for this introduction. Thanks for inviting me. It's I'm a bit astonished by the audience, but anyway, I'll do my best to give you a good speech after the eloquent speech of Sir Mark Walport, who touched upon several issues that were also behind our thinking in the European Commission with regard to the future of science and the impact it will have on the stakeholders. So I will briefly go over what do we understand by open science, why do we think not we only but the stakeholders in Europe, why do we think it is an issue, what are the likely effects, if at all, when someone can say something sensible about the future, how does the European stakeholders, how do they react to it, what were their view on it? So that was the big consultation we did last year, and all the validation workshops to which some of you participated. And then, since this week, because 2 days ago, our commissioner announced what he would like to do with it. So you will be the first one, actually, besides what he said 2 days ago, who I can communicate some of the actions our commissioner is planning to launch very soon. As you know, we have a new commissioner since a few months now, so Commissioner Modas, and he immediately, within the 2 months after taking office, took up the issue of open science, open access, open data, and he immediately made it one of his attention points, and you will see at the end of my speech, of you will hear better, and you can read it, that he takes it very serious for the rest of his mandate, which is still 4 years and 5 months to go. So we have a promising start there. So indeed, it was mainly my unit who did all the work behind this. It was something we did together with the colleagues from DG Connect, but the focal point is in my unit, and as Christine said, so I have a background myself for many, many years, longer in academia than in the Commission, so it is really a pleasure for me to be able, as a civil servant now, to work on this. So what is open science? And everyone has his definition about it. It's the way we see it is very largely concurring with how it was presented to you by Sir Mark Walport. When we started working on it 3-4 years ago, the way we saw open science was mainly looking at these blue things. We saw things happening in the world of how research and how science was done and the effects it had, which were new to the field of science. Well, some of these things started 10, 15 years ago, like open access. Some of them were much more recent, much more recent than others, like figshare or repositories for raw data, that kind of stuff. Some of them were well established, like open code. Some of them are completely new, like at least 3-4 years ago, like collaborative platforms for researchers like Mendeley, like academia, like ResearchGate, etc. And when you started putting them together, you saw a pattern that actually started to challenge the classical way of how research has been going on, or science has been going on for the last, let's say, post-World War II time. I mean, if you do it very schematically, you know, You start with your question, you go to a library, try to find your to be on top of your literature. 6 months later, you start to look where is the data. Most of the time they are not available, so you change your question again. Then then you try to find a promoter for your thesis who is willing to do it, and then you go and make your analysis. You 3 years later, you have a publication. 2 years later, it is reviewed, and then it starts again. Okay, I'm making a bit of a caricature of it, but you know, in the prehistoric days when I made my PhD, this is more or less how it went, irrespective of the discipline. Now, if you look at it, and then you put that on the blue dots, you actually see that what is happening is precisely has been said by Mark Walport, is that all of these elements of the classical life cycle of a research science project are opening up due to many reasons, and as a result of that are making it much more faster and much more easier in a certain sense to do research and science than it used to be. Data, one of the really important points, the data-drivenness of science makes it actually abundant, the number of questions you can raise, and as a result, precisely like Mark Walport said to it, it will probably have impact on our curriculum. We will have to teach our students again what the heuristics of data are, and that is something which is very important. So the whole issue about open science is not only about one element, it's not only about open access, it's not only about open data, it's not only about open source, it's not only about the research process, it's about the whole thing, plus the effects it has and will have on stakeholders and on the way we as a science community in the largest possible definition function. To give you one little example, alternative reputation systems, what we have with for example, ResearchGate or Mendeley is providing, you can very easily foresee, I'm not saying predict, but foresee that in 10 years' time, your ResearchGate factor might be something that is mentioned in your CV, in your curriculum. I'm not saying that it will take per se that form, but it could perfectly happen that your download behavior in those environments will be taken as serious as anything else. Just a speculation, not a prediction, not a value statement, but just to give you an example that it is much more than only changing the process itself, it also changes the stakeholders around it. And on top of it, and then that's when we started with our work, what we saw happening is that on all these blue dots, behind that you see an ecosystem of services and standards emerging. So it's not some geek somewhere sitting trying to find something out. It is real life. It is huge. You know the figures. Mendeley, 2.6 million. Academia EU, close to 8 million. Millions of articles available. So the figures behind it suggest that we are witnessing a paradigm shift, to use a heavy word, in how science goes. And that's when we introduce the concept, we go from the science 1.0 to 2.0. I come back on that in a minute. So that's the broad picture. And it is very important, I'm not going to spend too much time in this audience on that, it is very important to see that this is not only driven by one factor. There is a multitude of factors that drives the change. There is, of course, first of all, the fact that it is being made possible by ICTs, digital technologies, just like they revolutionized economy or social relations. Well, they are simply doing exactly the same for science and research, but it's much more than that. It leads to data-driven science, which opens up, again, enormous opportunities. It is also driven by the fact that the scientific population is growing X percent every year, and as a result, there are much more people in the market looking for subjects to be researched, for funds to be received, for careers to be made. As a result of that, you get pressure on the system as it is, etc. So you see, it is part of a wider movement. It is not monocausal, to say it in those terms. It is multicausal. And secondly, it is not happening in isolation. It is really what I think, what we have seen in the rest of society happening as a result of the internet you now see happening, this is my last point, precisely in the world of science and research. Plus, it responds to a certain new era of thinking, of doing in economy, collaborative economy as they call it, open source software which is proven to be a viable business model and so on. So it is not happening in isolation there. So all that together led us to the conclusion in Brussels, and after talking to many people, that we should try to go here to try to understand what are some of the deeper issues there and some of the opportunities, and try to see what the European stakeholders think about it. So we made an analysis which wrote more or less what I just said, but then a bit more scientifically packaged. So we made a paper on that, and we wanted to understand the opportunities, not only the challenges, but also the opportunities. Because open science, indeed, it offers, if it works, better value for money. By making the system more transparent, by making via open data reproducibility a standard feature, well, you just get more out of your investment because more people will be able to redo the experiment. I know that there is a whole discussion around it, that redoing experiments will also induce new costs. But you see the overall picture is probably that by having open science, you will have better value for money or better return on investment. It will also lead to a much more transparent and open system. And there I think you can, one of our German colleagues, I mean in the German science system, a very high placed professor at some point in time told us, listen, we cannot escape as a science community the need for being transparent and open because of the fact that we are continuously claiming we need to have so much investment of the GDP in science and research. Now there is an enormous pressure on us to put the books on the table, so to speak, in order to justify that huge investment, in particular in the Financial Times as which we are. And there, open science is probably one of the best answers. But also, more transparency. The fraud issue was already mentioned before. Well, the best remedy against fraud is more transparency, of course. The more it is verifiable, the easier it will be to detect fraud, because fraud is not invented with the internet. It exists, as you know, before that. So that is a second benefit. And then, of course, open science has all the promises to deliver a better relationship between science and society. And then the economic values of it, well, there are several studies, in particular with regard to open data, which give you some of the estimations that you see here. That open data, well, this is an Australian study, and this is an EU study, sorry, that it could generate that kind of growth for the European GDP. I personally have always a little bit of problem with these enormous figures. 2% of GDP growth by open data is enormous. Even if it is half of it, or even if it is 20% of it, it will be impressive. So it is something to be taken serious. So that's the context. Our decision makers in Brussels were convinced that it was something to be worthwhile pursuing. So we launched a consultation in the summer of last year across Europe, where we wanted to, first of all, understand if the awareness of the issue was shared amongst the stakeholders in Europe. Secondly, if the perception of the opportunities and the challenges was shared amongst the stakeholders in Europe. And if so, then if there was room for policy, and if so, for what kind of policy? Because in the end, we are policy makers, and that was the key question we would like to find out. So we launched that consultation. Over the summer, we got an enormous response, because the numbers there are absolute numbers, but behind almost every organizational response are thousands, if not hundreds, if not thousands of other organizations listed. So if for example, LIBER respond, well, that counts as one voice, but is of course much more in real terms. So we got a quite exhaustive response, to my own surprise, I must admit, because if that would have been negative, the whole issue would have been over. And I think that on the basis of that, we have a fair view of what European stakeholders, funders, researchers, universities, academies, research performing organizations, and the science industry, so the metrics people, the publishers, etc., what they think and what kind of view they share with us or not. So what are now then the most important outcomes of our consultation? And then what are the conclusions we make from that with regard to policy? So first of all, to explain you why I no longer speak about science 2.0, but because of I speak about open science. Really, we had a whole discussion inside the house. This is a funny story I like to tell every time, that some of my colleagues who have more power than me were not really convinced that science 2 was the right right term, others preferred open digital science. So we solved it, you say what, we will ask it. And so the last question in the consultation out of the 30 questions was, what is your preferred term that describes best what we were just shown in the rest of the paper? And as you can see there, open science was elected by you, by the stakeholders, to be more pertinent than science 2.0, and that costed me a few bottles of champagne, but okay, that's on top of it. So from now on, we only speak about open science. And actually, if you will see, if I come back to the speech of our, the positioning of our commissioner, it actually fits purpose much better than science 2.0. First series of questions, do you recognize the analysis? In other words, do you agree with the systemic change which we have been describing on that science is undergoing and the kind of consequences it might have? Overwhelmingly, you have to take the light blue, fully yes, and the dark blue, yes, but together. Overwhelmingly, the analysis was supported by most of the stakeholders. A few little hiccups here and there, but overwhelmingly, the stakeholders in Europe supported our analysis. Idem dito for, what do you see as the key drivers? We asked, so we listed all these changes that are happening and that lead to science 2.0 type of dynamics. Here again, you can see that overwhelmingly, the availability of ICT, the look for new ways of publishing and disseminating results in order to make careers, the fact that researchers are looking for faster ways to collaborate so that they get a quicker response to the questions they have, to distribute the knowledge production, etc. All these drivers were more or less subscribed or acknowledged by the stakeholders. Now the one that scored lowest, citizen science, well, low is still 44%. The intellectual honesty obliges us to say that if you ask an audience of scientific professionals if this is an important driver for the change, then it is quite logic that this is probably that this is ranked the lowest one. If you would ask this to a civil society at large, I'm quite sure it would be different. So don't take it too narrow there. What are the barriers? This is important because if okay, now the picture is we agree with the analysis, more or less, we agree with the drivers, but then what are the barriers? Because barriers are potential policy issues or not. There you can see that, again, take the light blue and the dark blue always together to have an image of what the response was in terms of agreeing with it or not. Well, the first barrier, and it fits completely the story or the opinions expressed by Mark Walport before me. The first most important barrier is how will an open science system guarantee the same quality, even not better, than before? And by quality, not only the quality of an article, but also the quality of data, the quality of blogs, the quality of collaborative research projects, and etc. So quality assurance is a key bottleneck, and we will take it up later on. A second barrier for open science, and that's a very important one, is that it was perceived by most of the respondents that, okay, it is an important trend, we would like to support it, but if there is no incentive for it at the individual level, why would a researcher doing his research being willing to go for more open science methods of working and distributing and publishing? In a nutshell, this is the classical question. I'm prepared to take part in open data as long as everyone else, as I can also take part in open data of the others, and if not, well, then it doesn't happen. And you see that kind of there are a lot of tricky or complicated discussions, not tricky, but complicated discussions behind it. But incentivizing open science is a key issue. If we really want, Mark Walpert also alluded to it, if you really think that data visualization is a new competence of the future, which I think it is, then we should in some way foresee a system where data visualization is seen as a part of a curriculum and part of an academic CV. You could probably imagine that in 10 years' time you have professors who are data visualization experts who never write an article but makes very nice graphs. I think the reality will push us there. But if the system doesn't reward it, because you need to have so many high impact journals published to get your tenure, well, then it will probably take a bit of time to fully develop data visualization as a self-standing profession in, and respected profession in academia. And by the way, this has happened in the past. Statistics, if you go to the history of statistics, well, when they started around in between the second, the two world wars, that was not seen as an academic discipline at all. Now we are so many years later, and it is the opposite. So these things have to be taken serious. Third most important barrier is at the level of infrastructures. We go for open data, we go for data-driven science. Internet of Things will only lead to much more data available, so much more explosion, exponentially, and so on. Fantastic, but who will host it, under what condition, what kind of operability, what will be the service layer on top of it, and who will govern it? In particular, in a European context where you have 28, if not more, regimes of governance of data for research. That came back over and over again as a very important bottleneck for open science in Europe. Then, implications for the societal system, or for society and economy at large, and for the research system. Very largely, we got confirmation of what we put in our questions. It will make science more reliable, more open, more reliable. It will make it, as a result, more efficient. Not perfect, but efficient. It also doesn't say it will. Open science is free science. It will make it more efficient, more reliable. It will allow a faster circulation of knowledge, and as a result, a faster circulation of a faster take-up, and as a result, faster innovation. I'm quoting here a recent article. I think it was, I forgot in which journal, about if the data about Ebola would have been published under open data regimes in the 80s and in the 90s, we would have had a remedy much faster than we had the last couple of years. According to the specialist, I'm not at all, I have no medical background at all, so I assume this is correct, and so on. So you see there more or less the same kind of perceived positive results of open science as the one put forward. Then we asked, what are the policy areas on that basis? So diagnosis, drivers, analysis, problems, barriers, and then what are the policy areas that you think we could take forward? I will spare you the details and come and then give you, if you look at that and you aggregate the results there, you have three clusters of policy areas where, according to the stakeholders, again, so we are simply bottom up here, according to the stakeholders, that we should look at the European level without specifying if it should be done in Brussels, in the member states, or at the local level. So first, and no surprise, given the importance of the issue of availability of data infrastructures for data-driven science, is of course we should find ways in Europe to support data-driven science at the level of access, hosting, and governance. Secondly, not surprisingly, given the issues about the incentives and the lack of incentives, we should work on the framework conditions to remove barriers and create incentives for fostering open science. And then a third area of policy attention, as called by the stakeholders, is that we should concentrate on trying to, via funding, make science much more efficient, reliable, and more responsive to the societal challenges. What was very important for us to learn when we took these conclusions and went on a tour of Europe, validating, and we did one here and also in the Royal Society, validating with specialists from your fields the questions. So what came back over and over again is that whatever we do in Europe, in this field, it will only work if it is bottom-up and if it is stakeholder-driven. In other words, to put it simple, it's not the opposite that should happen. It's not Brussels X should decide top-down what has to happen at any of these levels. And I think it makes perfect sense. It is really, it is a paradigm shift, so it is no reason, no one knows the outcome, so the best thing we can do is indeed try to tackle it together and develop in co-creation the solutions of the future. So that is the consultation. Now, what does it mean for us now as a policymaker? What did we do? First of all, open science is part in the new commission as one of the 10 initiatives of Juncker, of President Juncker, which is the digital single market. And secondly, the member states in their policy debate on open science in the May Competitiveness Council, so last month, fully endorsed our analysis and our initiative. So that's actually a political statement to say that, okay, go ahead with it. So here you have the details of the text, but the bottom line it says that indeed those areas are important. It's an important area. Europe should try to capitalize on it, and we should try to come up with a strategy that gets the best out of it for all the players. So then this week, so Monday and Tuesday, we were able to present all these results and policy actions to a big conference in Brussels, where our commissioner, for the first time of his mandate, came up with his vision for his mandate. So there, he, to the surprise of some, he said, well, I have three priorities. First is open science, second is open innovation, and third is open to the world. So triple O, it sounds well to sell in a PowerPoint. So these are the benchmarks, not the benchmark, these are the kind of concepts he would like to underpin his policy for the coming years. And that is, of course, very good news for us concerned about open science, because it's one of his three top priorities. And as a result of that, he said, and I will launch today, so 2 days ago, I want to launch a European Open Science Action Agenda. And that's where we are now. So this action agenda we will structure in line with the consultation and the outcome and the discussion and the stakeholders and what have you. So we will structure it around the three areas which came out of all that. First of all, actions around removing barriers and creating incentives. You see them there, some of the most important, but there are more. Secondly, some serious action around infrastructures, and here we will launch an initiative for a European Open Science Cloud, which is a hot topic for debate, and we can go on that very long if you want. If you want, I can, in the questions and answers, give you a few of the views of how we see it. And then thirdly, we will launch actions around embedding open science in society, e.g., putting more behind citizen science, citizens as participants, not as receivers or communicators, but citizens like Galaxy Zoo, citizens as producers of science. That's how we see it. And then via the funding instruments that we have in Europe, try to come up with the knowledge coalitions needed to address the societal challenges. Our commissioner insisted on having this slide that whatever we do, it must be bottom-up, it must be stakeholder-driven, what I just said before. And in terms of data, in terms of agenda, this is the rollout of how we will work now. So on the three topics, we will come up with some detailed suggestions. We will not do it ourselves. We will do it in consultation with, we have a whole mechanism for that I can explain later if you want. So that will be our famous stakeholder forum discussion that starts after the summer. Then we must finalize this in the final version of the digital single market strategy. I know that this all sounds a little bit far from your day-to-day reality, but for policymaking in Brussels, these are very important stepping stones. And then it will be announced in a wrap-up conference as the final action agenda on open science for Europe. That will take place 4 and 5 April in 2016. In the meantime, we have published a vision paper on our website. The website comes immediately on how science could look like in 2030. It's always fun to do this kind of futuristic kind of scenario exercises where we try to depict on the basis of what is available today how it could look like in the years to come. So I invite you to look at it. And I actually invite you more in general that this is a common endeavor. This is a huge thing with a lot of ramifications that go in all directions. It is a system change. As a result, everything is connected to everything. The open data or open access has impact on reputation system. Reputation system do push collaborative networks and so on. So we really need everyone available and willing to contribute on how to make the best out of this for Europe and to make the best out of it for the opportunities that open science has. So that's the website where you find the presentations, where you find the background documents, where you find the detailed responses to our consultation, where you find all the position papers, where you find the scenario, etc. So please, this is our call for, in particular for this audience, because you are the knowledge brokers of the Open Science Society, so to speak. So I would warmly welcome your contributions there, and with me, my colleagues. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for your really interesting talk. We have some time for questions. Would you have questions to start with? Let me check mine. Oh yes, there's one. He's the chair of our steering committee on scholarly communication and research infrastructure. Mike is coming behind you.
Yeah, hello. We can continue our discussion from the ERG meeting now. no, because I presented on the long tail of research, and it was a very interesting meeting we had 2 weeks ago, I think, in Riga, about what is actually the role of institutions, and came to the conclusion that what is considered to be the long tail of science is actually science, yeah, and that big data is actually a small thing of a few players, and that institutions must play a big role. And as you said, libraries are the knowledge brokers of open science, which is a very, very interesting concept. Thank you for this. The question I have is, when it comes to concepts like the open research data cloud, how do we make sure that this is actually something that can be used on the ground at each individual institution? Because libraries are, you know, the knowledge brokers, and they can help. And how can we prevent that it becomes a thing, an infrastructure without any living research in it that that is actually not used at the individual institutions?
Okay, so the first of all, this is this knowledge broker for the open science, this is copyright at this term, so watch out.
We will always cite you.
No, but I really think this is what the role is of library, in my personal view at least, but I'm not a librarian, but that's how I think I see it. And I like the conclusion of Mark Walport's speech in that respect. I think he's probably right on there. Now, on this open research cloud, as you can imagine, this is it's conceptually very easy to explain. We need a virtual environment in Europe where the existing infrastructure is, if it exists, and if not, if it is to be provided, where there is a seamless data cloud for doing research, in a way that everyone on the same condition can take part at the same at the same conditions in research endeavors without harming anyone else or without being at the detriment of anyone else. Something like that. So in order to do that, you need three layers. You need access, you need hosting, access, and governance. The access layer is pretty much already available, except that it is not so much interoperable. If you want to combine health data with transport data across Europe, good luck. So you have an access problem, you have a hosting problem, you have an access problem, and you have a governance problem, because the laws prohibit you to combine. Some of the laws prohibit you to combine. And if you think Internet of Things, the other day we were discussing it, actually in the future my car will be a node on the Internet, and all my traffic data will be somewhere visible in some space. Now, in a certain extent, I can say these are personal data. So you cannot use those data for many research purposes you would like to. So we need to find solutions there, because if not, we will not have a European space for it. It will happen, but it will happen dispersed. It will happen according to the discipline specific, probably country-specific, and as a result of it, as all science is global by nature, as all experiments, the more scale you have, the better. It will be at the detriment of the quality and of the average quality of European science. So we must find a solution there, and that I think is relatively easy to understand. And up till now, I think most experts agree with us. Now, if you have to design this, because actually, if you have to design this, you would have something like, oops, this is my screensaver actually. If you have to design the cloud, you would have something like this. So these are the data repositories available according to the disciplines. The higher you go, the more data intensivity, if you want, for the, so physical science, as we know, the longer you go to the long tail, that's where we started our discussion 2 weeks ago, the less is available. So you have, what you need to do there is not only have the data layer, so already we have problems there, some disciplines very well, some disciplines not at all, interconnection very difficult. You need a service layer, and you need a governance layer. Service layer, a common service layer, and a common governance layer are non-existing. So okay, this is maybe not perfect, but this more or less catches what are the parameters we need to develop. Now, how to make that happen, that I'm sure, to be very honest, I have no idea. I can pretend I have an idea, but actually that would not be a very honest way. I think this is a complex thing where we are foreseeing a lot of actions after the summer to start working on it, bring specialists together, and make sure that we have the stakeholders, the specialists behind us, that we can do this at the European scale. Because if not, it will probably be this picture, but then some of them will grow, others will diminish, and there will not be an interconnection, and it will be member state specific and so on. So that's the issue.
If I may say just one sentence, so this is exactly the answer to the question, so thank you very much for that. I think we can build on experience how to implement open access policy, because we are in the library domain very well organized to build this link between policy and implementation, and I think the open access policy showed that very much through LIBER activities, through open air activities. And the middle layer, the service layer, I think that would be something fantastic to work on together. Thank you.
Thanks.
And there is one question here in the front. It's not working. The mic is not working. Can we have another?
Is that working? Sure. Katrina McCallum from PLOS. It's a fantastic initiative, and the EC is really taking a leadership position in this. But research is a global enterprise, and how much do the EC intend to try and collaborate with the States, with China, with South America, and other places to build a truly global cloud?
Yeah, well, I not only the cloud, but the whole open science issue is a global issue. Why? Because, as you say, science is indeed global. And that is, again, is simple to say, but a little bit more complicated to put into policy. And not because we are stupid, which might be the case, but simply because, as you know, there are a lot of interests behind it, and it is really not easy to try to realize at the global scale these principles in the world which is the reality in which we live. But it is de facto, for me, it is self-evident that we need to find a global solution there, and that we have to work via the RDA, we have to work with the Research Data Alliance, we have to work via the Internet Society. By the way, it took 15 years to agree on the TCP/IP protocol, so if you are a little bit impatient on how fast it can go, well, this gives you some scale of the time horizon. But we have to work in a global context. And if you, the way we are thinking, but again, this is all premature, so these are not policy positions for the moment, which are stable. The way we are thinking about this thing is that it can only work in a global level if it is based on reciprocity. You cannot have your cloud to be open for anyone without having the same guarantee the other side of the Atlantic, wherever you want to be global. Otherwise, it will not happen. It's as simple. Again, but how to translate that into a policy is. I personally think, but this is my personal view, we will have to do something like what we did in the 90s, create the Internet Society, but then only for research and science. So only. Dedicated to research, the same kind of governance logic, the same kind of build-up, the same kind of stakeholder involvement at the global level, and then make it happen at the continental level. But that is premature to say that this is our position at all.
If I may, I have now two questions. First, a simple one, and perhaps the other one, I don't know. It can be simpler than more complicated. First of all, you mentioned these three action areas, which look very interesting for LIBER and for libraries. Actually, we have been quite active in these areas already. Will you be opening some new project funding to promote these action areas? So this was the first one. And the second one, so you have been receiving the feedback from the audience about open science and barriers and implications and all that. But personally, what do you see, what is the most challenging part in enabling open science?
Okay. So, this piece of cake. So the first question, we have foreseen funding for it. But in my personal view, not enough, but don't say it to my boss. But so there are some actions planned in the next work program, which will be launched after the summer. So there is a serious amount of money foreseen to do some test bedding on what the science cloud could be without being decisive. There is some money foreseen, some funds foreseen for citizen science projects, etc. I wish it would have been a bit bigger, but okay, you know the reality of funding as much and even better than I know, so, but we are getting there. In the same time, it's really interesting to see that member states are also taking the funding issue for this very, very seriously. This professor was mentioned, Tochtermann, so he's leading the Science 2.0 initiative in Germany. Yesterday we had a meeting together, so they will go very big for the next 6 years. So he's proposing an enormous, in my view, an enormous program for rolling out at the three levels this kind of initiative. So it should not only be Europe. Eh? Europe has only 5% of the funding budget has 5% of the funding budget of Europe. So 95% is at the member state. So if every member state put 5%, then we get a lot of funding together. So that is one thing. For me, the most, to your second question, at the level of creating the take up of the curve of open science in Europe, the most important thing is probably the cloud. Because if that will propel, I think, data-driven science across all disciplines, in particular social sciences, but that's another discussion. The most mid to long-term important thing to tackle are the incentives. If our academic system is not giving incentive for open science activities, it will slow down immensely the process. If the funders in Europe are not putting open science requirements in their funding specifications, and just take NIH or the Bill Gates Foundation, they make open access to data and to publications and data mandatory. Now that will create a spinning effect that is much bigger than whatever policy can do. So that kind of incentives are probably the biggest problems on the mid to long term.
Okay, so thank you very much. Very, very interesting.